is Jesus Christ. Let's stand as we sing. My hope is built on nothing less than in Jesus Christ.
Thank you. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just want to give you thanks for this day. Well, thank you, Father, for this church, for Brother Bob and Betty and leaders here. We just thank you so much for them. And Father, we thank you for the amount of moisture that you blessed us with. This we need more moisture, but thank you, Father, for what you give us. We want to ask, Father, that you be with the people in Ukraine, that there will be an end to this war, and these people can get back to their place, back to their country. We pray for those that couldn't be here with us this morning, those that might be traveling, or those that might be sick. Now that we want to ask all these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. I'm going to sing the verses to this song, and you guys join me on the chorus. If you feel like you want to sing the verses with me too, that's just wonderful. I've had many tears and sorrows. I've had questions for tomorrow. There have been times I didn't know right from wrong. But in every situation, God gave blessing, consolation, that my trials come only make me strong.
Sing it with me.
Through it all,
was brokenness and strife, but he made something beautiful about my life.
Once again,
something beautiful, something good.
Amen. Today we're going to tackle a subject I've preached on a lot, and it's really not the main message and the main thrust of what God wants us to learn out of this passage. Mark chapter 5, verses 1 through 20 describes the point where Jesus and the disciples had gone across the Sea of Galilee from, I was going to put a map up and forgot. If you'll remember the Sea of Galilee, you had Capernaum over here, if you're looking at the map. And then down here is the area called Gerasea, or of the Gerasenes, the people were called, or Gerasenes. I call them Gerasenes. And there's so many things that lead up to this experience where Jesus cast the legion of demons out of the man and into the pigs. And you remember that story. We'll get to that in just a moment. But we need to back up a minute, because if you look at the first verse on that says they came to the other side of the sea, to the country of the Gerasenes. Well, where'd they come from? I had to go all the way back to chapter 3 to figure out this party that they were coming through. And a lot happened on that trip. Chapters 3 and 4 are full of Jesus healing people. This isn't the first time he had cast a demon out. But in chapter 4, chapter 3, verse 14, it's when he called the 12 disciples. Do you remember that brief paragraph in there where he names the disciples? And it says he went off by himself and he got those to come with him that he selected. And then we have their names, all of the 12 apostles, and he called them apostles. The important thing and reason I bring that up is that in that passage of scripture, it says, and he appointed 12, whom he also named apostles, so that they might be with him and he might send them out to preach and have authority to cast out demons. It's interesting that Mark puts that in there, and it's in there in other books as well. And then it lists the name of the apostles. So we need to understand that demons are a reality. I was having a discussion with Betty yesterday, I think it was, and we were talking about some of the things that are attributed to a person being demonized. And one of those is mental health. And people in asylums and things like that, there is an element. Now, not everybody that has a mental health issue is demonized, okay? I'm not saying that at all. But there is an element of that. And Betty, if you don't remember, was a certified music therapist. After she graduated from college, she had to go and be an intern for a year, 6 months, at a psychiatric facility. And she's got some interesting stories. And she kind of verified in my mind's eye that concept that there's definitely an element of demonization that goes on in some of that. But not everybody there was demonized. And so, but that's important to know. But the important thing for us as Christians to understand is that demons exist. Demons are a reality. And they're still out there today doing what they do. I was reading the study that we're doing in Thessalonica, and several times Paul was saying, I wanted to come to you, but Satan blocked the way, my phraseology, for me to be able to come and see you again. And we know that Satan has minions, and we know that demons do exist. I've had at least one encounter that I'm pretty sure, and we prayed for the lady, and her countenance changed completely. This is not something you go out looking for, but in this particular case, it was kind of interesting. Just before they got to the shore where the Gerasenes lived, they went through that segment of the Sea of Galilee, and it's when Jesus was asleep in the stern of the boat, on a cushion, it says, and the storm was raging around the boat and around the disciples, and they were incredibly frightened and woke him up and asked him, "Don't you even care?" And then at the end of that, when he calmed the storm, and they said, my phrase, "Just who is this guy? Even the winds obey him." Now, they had already witnessed him casting demons out. They had already witnessed him doing many things, healing, I'll call it, dozens and dozens and dozens of people. If you look through those first three chapters of Mark, or first four chapters, there's one right after another. He began to teach in parables. You remember the parable of the sower? That's in that segment in chapter 3. But the point is, the disciples had already been with Jesus. They had just been basically commissioned by him. And here in the boat, they verbally say, "Just who is this guy? I put an outline together, and these are in your bulletin if you want to jot down a note or two around these items. But one is, I wanted to address the reality of demons. We just don't talk about that much. But it's important to know, and it's important to know that we have power over that, because God gave it to the disciples, and when he gave his power to us, Jesus lives in us. We say that a lot. The Holy Spirit dwells within us, and all of the power of God is available in that situation. Now, we don't go out looking for these types of situations, but that's the reason this, I saw the learning disciples. So Jesus here, when the issue comes with the man, the demoniac, coming out of the tombs, Jesus, a couple of things I wanted to note about that. Jesus said when they were in Capernaum, "Let us go to the other side." Jesus knew there was a divine appointment. Now, divine appointments are kind of an interesting thing that happens to us. Sometimes they come out of nowhere, and maybe we don't always follow through like we should, but we have an opportunity to share our life and share. I remember when Dom and I took a young man from the Oasis up to Perryton, got him a hotel room and some food and some things like that. There was no doubt, the man called me. So there was no doubt that this was already gonna be a divine appointment, because Dom and I didn't see it coming. I knew he had a dog, a fairly good sized dog, and not knowing him from anything, and the sheriff had already kind of ask him, we'll just put it there, that maybe he should leave this county and find someplace else to go. So the story was interesting, but we, Dom and I, knew that we had to share the gospel with this guy, because that was what was part. He said he was a Christian, and he did give some evidence, but we were able to extend a helping hand and give him a place to rest for the night, and I lost track of him after that. But that's not the point. I remember, you know, you've heard me tell the story so many times about street witnessing in Fort Worth with my evangelism class. And I never really thought about it, because I thought, well, I'm just doing what the teachers ask us to do. I mean, he didn't give us a mandate to go, but he gave us an opportunity. And we went with a famous man who had a ministry on Sunset Strip, Arthur to bless it. And that may not mean anything to you, that name-wise, but he went up and down, and he witnessed to the prostitutes and the drug addicts. And I remember one point I was listening to a testimony. He said, I saw my own father changed by the power of God when he was drunk. God just did it. But that place in Fort Worth, that situation in Fort Worth, it didn't dawn on me until this morning when I was thinking about this. That was a divine appointment. I just didn't know it was going to happen the way that it happened. And I was letting the young couple lead the way that was with me. And they were getting tripped up by all the questions they're being asked. And I just said, can I say something? And I asked the question. You've heard me say this many times. I just asked the man who had just come out of a convenience store. I just said, is there any reason why you can't ask Jesus Christ into your life right this minute? One word answer. No. We prayed, he prayed, he received Christ. Sometimes, more often than not, I'll confess, I'm not as alert as I should be when divine appointments show up. But we need to take a new view, I think. As I was thinking through this, every day that I wake up and I interact with other people, or I go to this little store I go to in Perryton, it's got a good price on gasoline, and I use my Phillips 66 app, but I interact with those people on and off. I don't always even go in the store, but I'm always meeting people and greeting people. But think about it. Every day we wake up is a divine appointment. Jesus Christ in person of the Holy Spirit lives inside of us. And everything that we do and everything that we say needs to be couched in our minds with the philosophy that God allowed me to wake up today. I am on mission. I get to sing at various senior citizens events from time to time. Hasn't happened in a while, but I always sing that song, The Touch of the Master's Hand, the famous poem that's set to music. And I always point out to them, if you're still breathing, you're on mission. If you need Jesus. I tell you what, I had never planned to say any of that. But anyway. But then there was the miraculous power of God. Now let's look at another side of the coin here. Let's just read it for a second. It's 20 verses, but it goes by pretty fast. They came to the other side of the sea, to the country of the Gerasenes. And when Jesus had stepped out of the boat, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. He lived among the tombs. No one could bind him anymore, not even with chains, for he had often been bound with shackles and chains, but he wrenched the chains apart and broke the shackles in pieces. And no one had the strength to subdue him. Night and day, among the tombs and on the mountains, he was always crying out and cutting himself with stones. And when he saw Jesus from afar, he ran and fell down before him and worshiped him. And crying out with a loud voice, he said, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I adjure you by God, do not torment me," for he was saying to him, "Come out." For he was saying to him, "Come out of the man, you unclean spirit." And that was the unclean spirit talking back to him. And Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" He replied. He's talking to the demon now. "My name is Legion." A legion in the army is 6,000 soldiers. I don't know that we can superimpose that number over this situation, but it said we're legion, for we are many. And he begged him earnestly not to send him out of the country. Now, a great herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside, and they begged him, saying, "Send us to the pigs so that and let us enter them." So he gave them permission, and the unclean spirits came out and entered the pigs, and heard the numbering about 2,000, rushed down the steep bank into the sea and drowned in the sea. Well, it made 2,000 pigs go straight crazy, so there was a lot of demons. Couple of things to really notice here. Jesus gave them permission. They already recognized that Jesus had authority over them when they were talking to him. They knew they were in the presence of God, and that the deal was up. They knew they were facing something powerful ahead of them, and they asked to go into the pigs. No special thing about the pigs, except that, you know, that they were considered to be unclean and not fit for food by the Jewish people. So, but they went to the pigs because the demons asked to be put in the pigs, so Jesus gave them permission. Jesus has to give the devil permission to mess with us. You realize that? You remember the book of Job? The whole book of Job starts out with Satan talking to God and saying, "Well, you've got this hedge of protection around him. Nothing can get to him." Jesus, or the Lord said, "Okay, but you can't take his life." So there is an interesting thing there about demons. But the most important thing to note here about demons is that God is consummately powerful over everything. He's the creator of the universe. Demons, no problem. But I think it's important for us today in this world, we don't talk about this because we don't encounter it a lot, or if we do, we don't recognize it at that moment. But the miraculous power of God comes into play and takes over the situation. Do you know what the most important message in this whole thing is? Yeah, God, he was teaching his disciples. He was giving them direction. He was showing them new ground when he told the wind to be still. And they were confused and they were still learning. And this experience is the next step in the disciples' learning experience, because he'd already given them authority over demons when he called them, the 12 disciples, in the chapter before. But now, he's showing them what they can do. God's power is in us. And that's why, when the people of the Gerasenes asked Jesus and his disciples to leave the area, as they were getting into the boat, remember what happened? Let me read it to you. Herdsman told it, this is verse 14, and the country and the people came to see what had happened, and they explained to them all the things. And so in verse 18, and as he was getting into the boat, the man who had been possessed with demons begged him that he might be with him. And he did not permit him, but said, "Go home. Go Go home to your friends and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you. And he went away and began to proclaim in the Decapolis, the town, how much Jesus had done for him, and everyone marveled. Jesus told him to go home. I don't need you to travel with me. I got enough guys. But what I need you to do is go home and tell what happened. Are we getting the message here? This is the message of the passage. God has done great things for us, folks. He sustained his church over these many years. You've seen miracles happen and lives changed. And the reason Jesus told him to go home, because home is the best mission field in the world. Not decrying the missionaries that God calls to go to other places to minister. The Lord only knows the need for missionaries right now in Ukraine and Poland and all of those countries, all the way to Switzerland, I think some of them are. First thing you do at home is teach your family how to live for Jesus. And the second thing, you look at home in the broader scope. The place that we live and the places that we go on a daily basis and the people that we see. I want to read you the last line in my sermon notes. Question of the day. I thought for a while after Betty was teaching in Sunday school the things she was saying, I don't think I'm going to have to preach today. Except her part didn't include anything about demons. Because there are so many lessons here. But she asked a similar question. And I decided that this needed to be the last point of today, even though I didn't put it on the PowerPoint. But the question of the day is our life a living demonstration of the power of God? We all have to answer it in the way that God puts us all in different places. We interact with different people. But that's why he told him to go home and demonstrate. I guess Jesus kind of gave the demonstration, but he reiterated the demonstration that Jesus had given to him and the change that God had made in his life. They knew who he was. He was running around naked in the tombs. And the first thing that he did was put clothes on when he came to his right mind. So, last question. Is our life a demonstration of the power of God? The God that we worship, the God that we adore, person who has changed us, given us blessings uncountable, and continues to lead us and guide us and encourage us to go forth. Last thing he told the disciples was go teach, preach, and baptize. He's still telling the disciples sitting in this room same thing. Because the power of God knows no boundaries. The power of God knows no particular one person or place, but all who are willing like that man. And he went, and he went home, and he told the people, and they were amazed. There's some other things that I thought I wanted to say, but I don't think I need to go any further. Jesus Christ, Son of God, the Creator of the universe, is telling us to go home. And maybe for us, since we are home, maybe he would say, be home for me. Be home for me. Heavenly Father, we thank you. Oh, we thank you so much for these stories about Jesus that give us so much encouragement and so much teaching and so much higher levels of understanding that we understand our place in this world. And our place is to preach the gospel to everyone. And if they don't listen, that's not on us, it's on them. But I pray, Lord, that you would reach out to those that may be watching this video. Reach down into their heart and encourage them and move them. May they feel you wooing them toward you, beckoning them to come to you and believe in you. Repent of your sins and trust Jesus as your personal Savior would be my prayer for you. Jesus, it's in your name we pray. Amen. Would you stand as we sing?
Your eyes upon Jesus, the cold in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory.
Be example of God. Just guide us and direct us throughout this coming week. Be with all those people that are hurting in any way, and Lord, there are many. Just be with those, our leaders, so that they will make the right decisions. Be with the people in Ukraine. Guide us and direct us, and forgive us for our sin.